Dear viewer, good evening and welcome to Spotlight. With me tonight, a person, a friend of the community, a friend of mine, and the community knows him so well because he attends every event in the community, in the whole Middle Eastern community. With me, Supreme Court Judge David Viviano. Mr. Viviano, welcome to MEA.
Wally, it's very good to see you as always. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. David, can you tell me, a lot of people know you, but they don't know how you grow, which school you go, when you got married, how many kids you have. Tell me more about David Viviano.
Sure. Well, I've been very fortunate to grow up in a large family. My father's Italian. My mother is Lebanese. Uh-huh. There are seven of us in our family. I have five sisters and a brother.
Big family.
I followed in my dad's footsteps into law, but before we got into law, our family was in the flower business, uh-huh. the Viviano Flower Shop, and so
That's
we all
right.
all of us grew up working there at the flower shop when we were young. I went on to school.
What school do you want?
I went to De La Salle Collegiate High School in Warren,
okay.
and then on to Hillsdale College mm-hmm. and the University of Michigan for law school. I followed my dad's footsteps into law.
Yes.
He became a judge and was the chief circuit judge in Macomb County, and I had the privilege of serving on the bench with him for 4 years before he retired.
Yes.
And when he retired, then I had the privilege of serving with my sister, Kathy Viviano,
yes.
who's now the business court judge in Macomb County. And so we've always had a big presence in the county with my dad's family, his brothers and sisters living in different parts of the county.
Yes.
I had an aunt who was in Warren, involved in the Warren Consolidated Schools, another aunt who taught out in Armada,
mm-hmm.
and of course my Uncle Frank and his family over in St. Clair Shores, and we grew up in Clinton Township, and so I feel really rooted.
So you are Macomb County person.
Feel very rooted in the community and in
yes.
the county, and the county's been very good to my family, first in the flower business and then of course in politics and when we've run for election.
I see. When did you get married? How many kids you have?
So my wife Niran and I got married in 2009.
Uh-huh.
We got married at St. George Chaldean Catholic
of course.
Church.
Yeah.
And we have four children now. We've been blessed with four children.
God bless them.
Yeah, thank
yeah.
you very much. My
yeah.
son Antonio will be 12 this year. My daughter Gianna is 10. My daughter Gabriella will turn 9 this year, and our youngest Cecilia just turned 7.
Great. How many of them they going to be judges?
Because
the whole family.
According to them, at least 2 or 3.
At least, God, yeah. God bless
them. No, they're doing great. They're healthy and happy, and yeah. keeping us very busy.
Great. Tell me how you started with the being a judge. When did you elect or appointed as a judge, and how we went to the Supreme Court?
I ran for judge in 2006 for the Circuit Court in Macomb County,
uh-huh.
And was elected that year to my first term on the bench. I was reelected again in 2012 mm-hmm. to another 6-year term. And then a little bit after that, I was appointed by Governor Rick Snyder to the Michigan Supreme Court.
I see.
Judges in Michigan are elected, as we all know.
Sure.
You can also be appointed by the governor, but mm-hmm. after you're appointed by the governor, you have to run in the very next election to have that appointment approved by the voters. So I had to do that in 2014. I ran statewide for a partial term,
mm-hmm.
and then I ran again in 2016 for a full 8-year term on the Supreme Court.
So next time is going to be in the 24?
That's right. My term ends in 2024, and that's
yes.
when I'll be up for re-election.
Okay. Mr. Viviano, tell me what Supreme Court business every day. What kind of cases they handle, or they handle different cases. Give me an idea what Supreme Court's
sure.
cases that they cooked in front of you.
So much like the U.S. Supreme Court,
yes.
we are very careful about which cases we choose. We don't take, we turn down a lot of cases. Our system has an appellate court, the Michigan Court of Appeals, and that's where everyone's right of appeal goes. So most cases, as everybody knows, you have a right, if you don't like the judge's decision
appeal
below,
yeah.
to appeal.
Yeah.
And so the Court of Appeals handles the large volume of cases. At the Supreme Court level, we try to spend our time on cases that have a statewide impact, the very most important cases to all of our citizens. We try to find areas of the law where the Court of Appeals has struggled maybe to clarify the law or to get correct rulings, because the most important thing is for our citizens to have guidance and have an understanding of what the law requires of them so they can make decisions yes. ahead of time to do what all of us hope to do, of course, which is to avoid going to court in the first place. So in terms of subject matter, we about half of our cases are criminal cases. We end up hearing most of the most serious criminal cases.
That's
appeals.
Individual or in yeah. general?
Yeah, yeah. Well,
it could be individual.
Right, right. Yes. So if someone has been convicted of a murder case for a murder charge,
yes.
that case typically will be appealed all the way to our court. So the more serious the charge is, the more of an incentive I think the parties have to appeal the case to the Supreme Court. So we usually see the most serious criminal cases. For example, we just heard an appeal in the Flint water prosecution
yes.
Cases. But then we also hear all variety of civil cases, whether they have to do with contract disputes, business disputes, personal injury cases, workers' comp cases, family law cases, divorce or custody type situations. All of those kinds of cases can be appealed to our court. So it's one of the most interesting things about being a circuit court judge is you hear all different types of cases. You know, most mm-hmm. lawyers, like everyone else in the world, specializes now in very narrow areas, but judges get to be generalists and get yes. to hear all different kinds of things. And at the mm-hmm. Supreme Court level, it's even a broader array. So that's been interesting.
How many judges we have in the Supreme Court?
In Michigan, there are seven judges on the Supreme Court.
Is the decision by the Supreme Court is final?
It is final in most cases, and I was just going to say, everything yeah. we decide is by majority vote, so individual judges can't make decisions on their own. We have to have convince at least four people on our court mm-hmm. whether to take a case and then how that case should come out. What we decide is final in every type of a case unless there's a claim under the U.S. Constitution, in which case, on occasion, the cases can be appealed to the United States Supreme Court directly from our court to the United States Supreme Court if there's a federal constitutional right being claimed.
Okay, if the federal Supreme Court take a decision, is that going to be the same decision you're going to take? I mean, you're going to look at the same?
If it relates to federal law,
yeah.
then we have to follow what the U.S. Supreme Court says. But what people don't understand is that the federal court's jurisdiction is pretty narrow. They hear a very few sort of few cases in comparison to the number of cases that are heard in the state court system. So, for example, most criminal cases that are out there yeah. are heard in the state court system. Only criminal cases that involve violations of federal law, and for example, a murder case, unless it involves a federal agent or occurs on federal property, all of those cases are going to be heard in the state court system.
Yes.
As I mentioned, our decisions are final in those cases unless the defendant is claiming a right under the U.S. Constitution.
I see. What I understand, soon they're suggesting that to be hearing the cases online. And you've been judged for a long time in different level and all that. What do you think about this?
I think it's very important for us to hear cases in person. I think that the quality of our decision-making, the judge's ability to understand the situation, to read the body language of the participants, to understand what's going on in a case, improves dramatically. I've spent a lot of time in the courtroom myself and have had many very good interactions, even with, for example, criminal defendants who are on probation, who you're trying to help learn to make better choices in their lives and have an impact that way. I think that we all have an obligation in government to be as efficient as we can and to use the tools of technology to do that.
Yeah, but communication one-to-one is very important.
No, that's exactly right. So we do things like e-filing, and maybe there's some types of routine hearings that can be done either by telephone or in a video conference, but all the important hearings where somebody's rights are being adjudicated, where a judge is deciding whether to send somebody to jail or not, or whether to award custody of their children, who's going to receive custody, all those important decisions, in my view, should be made in person. I think our citizens deserve that. They deserve to have their day in court, and I don't think they should settle for anything less.
Okay. If, for example, the government could go against your decision?
It's possible that my court is discussing and thinking about implementing rules that will make virtual court on via Zoom on a computer screen to become the default type of court hearing in Michigan. We would be different, I think, than just about every other state in the country if we were to do that. And so people, the default assumption would be that most case types would be heard via Zoom. I, as I mentioned already, think that's a big mistake, and I hope people will assert their rights and demand to be in court.
Okay. Judge Viviano, what we see with the Supreme Court judge and the leak and what happened after the leak, threatening their life, going to their houses, demonstrate, and threaten them if they don't change what they have in mind, whatever it is, okay? And in many occasions, they will go against them. And we have the majority leader in the Senate standing in front of the Supreme Court and threatening the Supreme Court judges. What do you think about this? I mean, how do you
Well,
look
I
at
think
it?
That's I think that's outrageous for people in government to be protesting outside the court in a manner that's designed to influence the court or intimidate its members.
That's the most important.
That's exactly
demonstration. Fine. If you have an opinion, we'll hear it. But not threaten. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, that's you have it exactly right. We have all have a First Amendment right to our own opinions. But the court operates outside of the realm of politics. The courts are nonpartisan.
Yes.
The courts are not there to decide cases based on what the most people want. Sometimes the court, the judge is the only person standing between the mob and a very unpopular criminal defendant. And so judges have to respect people's constitutional rights and protect those rights and give people a fair trial, even if the community doesn't have that patience and would rather exact vigilante justice. And so it's very important if we're going to remain a society that's under
respect,
the rule of law.
Respect the law. And the, yeah.
That we respect that process and that
yes.
we make sure that judges have the ability to be independent and to be impartial. If people think that we want a society where judges can be bullied and intimidated, you can think pretty easily how that will end up. If the most powerful people or the people with the most money
yeah.
always win cases, that won't be good for poor people. And that won't be good for the middle
or
class
the people.
People
in power.
That's
know.
Right.
Yeah.
And so when we think that if your political voice, you know, for politics, and if you can have the loudest bullying voice, you should win. That's not how our court system has operated in this country. It's not how it should operate, and it will break down very quickly if judges feel intimidated and if their safety and security is not protected as it should be. So I hope and expect that the Congress will vote as they were going to provide security for the U.S. Supreme Court justices at their homes. I think it's really outrageous that people would protest outside their homes.
They already put the fence in the Supreme Court, but we need to protect them where they live, when their children and their families.
Yeah, the fence outside the court is what it is. If that's what they feel that they need for security, it's unfortunate.
Yeah.
That's the society that we live in. But people have traditionally gone there to protest. But to go to someone's house where their family, where their children live in their neighborhoods is really... there's just not enough respect for the traditions and the customs and the institutions of our society and of our government, the things that we should all cherish, the things that have protected our freedoms from our founding
mm-hmm.
and made this the freest and most prosperous nation on the face of the earth. People seem to forget all those things, all those rights that people have fought and died for over the years.
That's right.
And I hope we start remembering them.
Yeah. Judge, I know you run your court as a Supreme Court, not just you, but any Supreme Court, very confidential. What do you think about the leak that came from the Supreme Court? How dangerous is this for now and the future?
I think it is an attack on the institution of the court. I think that whoever is responsible should be held accountable in whatever way is proper. If it's illegal
yes.
what they did, they should be prosecuted. I think it's unethical. So at a minimum, the person should have difficulty with their bar license and maybe have their license suspended or revoked. It goes to the ability of courts with multiple members to deliberate and decide cases. And if you can't have faith and trust in the members of the court and their staffs to protect the confidentiality that's always been part of the process, then once again, the system breaks down and will break down even further. I think it's time for people to stand up for what's right and to stand up for these institutions. So I hope that they will go and take a lot of time and effort to find out who did this.
Sure, and the Congress should put any effort possible to find out and help the Supreme Court to find out who is this and give the harshest punishment.
I think that's exactly right. If there's not a law against it, then the Congress should probably create one.
Yeah. Judge, I'm going to ask you a few questions. We see the country honestly divided. We see more radical from both sides, radicals and all that. We have the border. What do you think about the border? As you, Judge, we have America as multinational of all the ethnic minority, but they all come legal, and we welcome them, and we are part of that. But what happened in a border? What do you think? Give me your thought about it.
What I think has made this country the envy of the world is the rule of law, that people follow the law, that the police enforce the law, and the court system adjudicates the cases that become before the court. When it comes to immigration, of course, we're a nation of immigrants. It's been very important throughout our history for mm-hmm. both of our families.
Absolutely.
Who've immigrated to this country. But people who want to join us and become citizens of our country should follow the rules like everybody else.
Yes.
They should apply for citizenship, and they should wait until their applications are adjudicated in the immigration courts, in the immigration system. I think people should wait in line, as a lot of other people have already done.
Absolutely.
And so I, you know, would hope that those laws will be enforced better than they have been so far, because when we have an open border, we all can see in the news what's happening on the southern border.
It's going to affect every state.
In every aspect of life, including people coming into the country, bringing in illegal drugs that are affecting life throughout the country. And so
terrorists, the drug dealers, everybody coming with.
Right, right. Yeah. Yeah, there's no regulation. So I think we need to return to a situation where people respect the rule of law, and everybody's responsible for their choices and for their behavior.
People respect our country, not just come, you know, bringing the drug dealers and.
Yeah, no, that's right. That's right. They respect the country.
Yeah.
And the government, and they understand the rules are going to be enforced equally, by the way, against everyone.
Absolutely.
Whether you're an immigrant or a citizen or anyone else who breaks the law should face the consequences of their choices.
Sure. Judge, we've seen the crime, growing more than 30%, 50%, Chicago, New York, Los Angeles, Seattle, everywhere. Thanks God, Michigan, we have it under control. But as a judge, and when you see a criminal go into court and 2 months later he's in the street, what do you thought about this?
It's the same that we just talked about. We have to follow the rule of law. And so the legislature makes the laws. They define the crimes and the punishments for those crimes. I think too much in our society we have prosecutors who've decided that they're not going to prosecute certain crimes.
Yes.
And I think that there's been a revolving door with some people who are committing crimes. I think there are serious backlogs in a lot of our court, and so people are out on bond, on a tether, mm-hmm. committing new crimes before their first crimes are even adjudicated. And so I think, again, we need to return to a time in this country where people respect the law and understand that if they're gonna break the law, there's gonna be serious consequences for that. It doesn't mean that if a police officer violates their oath and mistreats somebody that they shouldn't be held accountable.
Would be first to stand.
And same, by the way, as a judge. If a judge violates the law, mm-hmm. nobody's above the law in this country. So everybody should be held accountable. But it's just not a good situation when people don't feel safe walking the streets in their own neighborhoods.
That's right.
There's a lot of our cities where people don't feel safe coming to visit in the cities around the country. As you mentioned, fortunately in Michigan, we've done pretty well with crime, but it's a very challenging situation.
The prosecutors, theft is not a crime, you know. You're hitting somebody is not a crime, unless you kill them or you, you know, and then it's a crime.
It's hard to understand what's...
How are we going to look at the law?
Yeah, it's hard to understand what those decisions that are being made around the country. And again, I'm not involved in those cases.
Yes.
And they're not Michigan cases. But I think
we feel as a nation, we feel bad what's happening, you know. I mean, Chicago, not too far from us. New York, not too far. And it could come to Michigan.
I think that executive branch officers and prosecutors should enforce the laws, and they should not pick and choose between the laws. And I think that judges will then make sentencing decisions based on the facts of each individual case, but they should be given the latitude to punish people who need to be punished, and also to show mercy when people deserve mercy.
Absolutely.
And to help people rehabilitate themselves when they show an interest in doing that. There's all sorts of, you know, there's not one way to handle every type of a case, but it does seem pretty apparent that the approach that most of these people are taking, these prosecutors, is not working. And it's really affecting the level of safety and security of our citizens. It's affecting the willingness of police officers to enforce the law vigorously. And it's really become an unfortunate situation.
I see. We see the inflation, the gas prices. Is there any way Supreme Court judges or could prevent that or could affect it? No, we have to do something different.
Boy, I wish there was something we could do to fix inflation. That goes a little beyond our warrant and our power, unless there's an individual case that challenges a particular policy of the government. If it's some type of a claim that it's illegal or against a statute
or
constitution.
Yeah.
Yeah, you just hope that the policymakers who do have the ability to make decisions that impact inflation treat it with the urgency that it deserves. I can tell you in my own household, we're impacted by the increase in prices of gas and food.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And
some of them 30%, some of them 50%.
And yeah. I know lots of people who are in much more challenging situations than we are, that this is the number one issue. And so I do hope that the policy making branches of government respond to it.
I see. A lot of Ukrainian living in Macomb County. And probably you know a lot of them because you are involved. What do you think about the war in Ukraine?
We do have a great Ukrainian community.
Yeah, Yugoslavia and Ukrainian, Albanian, all close to each other.
Yep, they have the churches here, they have a festival here,
yes.
They have cultural center here.
Mm-hmm.
I think the war is very unfortunate. I think it's barbaric.
Yes.
When one country with all of the military might that Russia has attacks its neighbor, for no apparent reason, and they're killing innocent civilians.
That's the most important.
And they're destroying cities.
Destroying countries completely.
It's hard to understand what purpose is served by sending missiles into apartment buildings.
Or a school or a hospital.
I think it's very tragic what's going on there. I do think, of course, that the United States has to be careful about how much we are getting involved in foreign conflicts, and
yes.
certainly with Russia being a nuclear power.
Yes.
I don't know that I know the solution to that, but my heart breaks for the people of Ukraine, because I do believe that the civilian population
refugees, over 5 million refugees, and you know, leaving their house with everything in it and run from the country.
And there's be nothing there when they return.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Finally, Mr. Viviano, you are Italian, Lebanese, Chaldean. You are part of that, what do we call it?
Melting
mosaic. That the Middle Eastern get together with Chaldean, Lebanese, Italian. They all have almost same culture, same foods and everything. How you see the Middle Eastern community compared to 20 years ago? Are you seeing advance involving in a political, social, or business enough to satisfy you where we're at?
Absolutely.
I'll give you 2 minutes for that.
Yeah, well, I think it's a good question. I think that what you see, you know, I think you're talking about in Michigan and in our local community,
Michigan.
Right?
We broadcast in every state in the nation.
Right.
So there is Middle Eastern everywhere.
All
so
over.
Your message is to them.
But the I think that the community here really has progressed across all the different ethnicities, you know, and countries of origin. So, you know, I'm part Lebanese, and you know, in the Dearborn community, and that community is growing out here in Macomb County as well. And the Chaldean, yes. My wife, of course, is Chaldean. My children are Chaldean. Mm-hmm. People from the Middle East are getting more involved in local politics and expressing their voice.
Yes.
They've always had an entrepreneurial streak that I admire, and I look at my own family members and my own grandfather, my Jiddu on the Lebanese side. It was a restaurateur in Akron, Ohio, and I see that same spirit with all the stores and restaurants and gas stations and businesses.
A business mentality,
and,
you know.
Now hotels, and yes. As it progresses into other areas and real estate, I see people who are risk takers and who have confidence, are able to withstand downturns of the economy. They're resilient,
yes.
The resiliency of people that are here. And I also see people who appreciate this country and believe in the American
Absolutely.
Dream in the old-fashioned way, mm-hmm. that we're a land of opportunity for people who work hard and take risks.
Yes.
And so I think it's vital, the Middle Eastern community is vital to Macomb.
And they kept the same culture and family value and getting close to each other and feeling each other.
Yeah, I think the values of faith and family
and yes.
food and
food, most important.
it is. Well, because that's how we engage with each other.
That's right.
And having a meal is an important occasion,
sure.
right? It
mm-hmm.
means something. That's why what happened in COVID when people were apart or trying to have a new world where we only can meet on a computer screen, that's not going to satisfy people
Absolutely
like us
not,
who
of course.
We want to be together. And so I have profound respect and admiration and gratitude for people from the Middle East who have come here to our country and who are now part of the fabric of this great land.
Yes. Well, George, thank you so much. Thank you for coming here. Thank you for all the information. And honestly, we needed somebody with your position as a Supreme Court judge to explain what's happening and to give us an idea what you think about it, what should be. So we thank you so much. And we all, the Middle Eastern and our Italian friend, very proud of you.
Thank you, Wally.
Thank
I really,
you so much.
I really appreciate it. One last message is
sure.
We want more people from the community to get involved, more young people to get involved and become leaders in our community and in our state and in our country, because we are desperate for good leadership.
And that's very important. And we should invest especially in our qualified young people and guide them to go and evolve within the American political system.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. And I see lots of them coming up in the legal system, so that makes me happy.
Good. Thank you so much. Thanks for working.
Thank you, Wally.
Thank you. Thank you again. Dear viewer, that was my interview with a person, we call him part of the family. And he is part of the family. And you see him in every event, talking to our people. And many people, they feel him, he's a family, he's a friend. Let me go and talk to him and shake his hand. And we need all the leader in the Middle Eastern community to be like this, to get involved with the community, to see what they need and what their issue, and to work with them, especially the people in a power, in an administration, or in judges, or police department, all that. Engage them with you so you relay the message to them and relay the issue to them. And please, wherever you see them, shake their hands because they're doing a great, great, great job for us. Thank you for watching and good night.